is focusing on the keynote address both from the international perspective and from the Nepal national perspective. So I'd like to request Dr. Mai Chu Chen, our board of director, to chair this session, please.
Your Excellency, Honorable Minister of Education, distinguished guests, and friends of RNET from all over the world, I'm really pleased and it's a great pleasure for me to chair this session and be able to introduce to you distinguished speakers as our keynote speakers for RNET conference. And this year we are very privileged to be able to invite Dr. Aisha, Yousafzai, who is the Associate Professor of Global Health at the School of Public Health at Harvard University. But she has done her work for the past 15 years at Aga Khan University on field research. And she has her team in rural Sindh, Pakistan. And she's interested in translating research into practice. And we'll be able to hear the extra stories from her research. We are very pleased she's able to join us at this session and tell us about how to translate research into action. And she has extensive experience in evaluating early childhood interventions in South Asia, East Africa, and in Central and Eastern Europe. She also serves on these several advisory groups on early childhood development, including the ECDAN. It's a new group called Early Childhood Development Action Network. And she's going to be speaking on implementation research, practice, and partnerships, informing a multi-sectoral approach to ECP. Let's welcome Dr. Aisha Yousafzai.
It is a great honor and a privilege to be invited to speak at this year's RNET conference. And I'd like to begin just by acknowledging on its 10th anniversary how important RNEC has been to the region, not only in terms of convening great conferences like this one, but also for all of us as a community working in the region to bring us together, to keep us informed, engaged, provide opportunities for networking, collaboration, really to innovate for the children across the region. And really, this year is quite a momentous occasion. We have many reasons to be cheerful in the field of early childhood development. It was only 10 years ago, just over 10 years ago in 2007, when the first Lancet series in early childhood development was launched. And this raised the visibility of the global challenges we needed to address together to ultimately improve children's development. It gave us the figure that 250 million children were failing to meet their developmental potential in the first 5 years of life. In the time since 2007, we have seen an explosion in the science, an explosion in advocacy that has really helped to transform our knowledge into action. And just to illustrate this, in the year 2000, we only had 7 national multi-sectoral ECD policies. By 2014, this number had increased to around 68 multi-sectoral national policies. That's incredible progress. And so we've really done well in making the case for why we need to invest in holistic multi-sectoral interventions for young children. However, we now need to move forward in understanding better how to translate that into actions that helps us to move and advance programs to scale. And the Sustainable Development Goals provides an opportunity for us to be able to do that. They allow us to convene around focused targets for young children. Target 4.2 is the one that we explicitly talk about early childhood development. Improving access and quality to these early childhood services is essential. But in order to reduce the number of children that are really failing to meet their developmental potential, we cannot focus on target 4.2 alone. We need to pay attention to other sustainable development goals, including those to reduce child poverty, reduce child hunger, improve child survival, and improve the safety and protection of young children. These goals are interconnected. We cannot think of them in an isolated manner when we think about programming for young children. So in this presentation, I'll take you through the nurturing care framework, which has been described briefly this morning, which is really our roadmap for developing multi-sectoral approaches for child development. I'll talk about the evidence-based principles that we need to consider when designing multi-sectoral packages, and really the opportunity that we have to create strong implementation, research, and policy partnerships, as well as practice partnerships, to really implement successful multi-sectoral approaches. So the Nurturing Care Framework was launched by the World Health Organization and global partners at the World Health Assembly last month. The components point to the importance of holistic inputs for young children, including good health, adequate nutrition, safety and stability, responsive caregiving, and opportunities for early learning. The framework really provides impetus for all of us to have a responsibility to meet the needs of young children across all sectors. But here's the challenge. What is it that we have to do differently? After all, the education sector is already responsible for delivering preschool education. The health sector is already responsible for providing health inputs for young children, as well as for promoting infant and young child feeding. So there are three areas that the framework really provides guidance on. The first is to reimagine how we work towards the promotion of strengthening early childhood development outcomes within the sectors that we work and across the sectors in partnership. It's an opportunity for new interventions, for example, integrating stimulation or early learning within health services. It is an opportunity for us to work differently with caregivers. And really, this is not just thinking about caregivers as immediate family providers, but also our frontline workers, to equip them with the knowledge and the skills so that they are empowered to deliver on meeting the holistic needs of young children. This sees our caregivers not as recipients of interventions, but as actors actively involved in the change for progress. And critically, the Nurturing Care Framework points towards the need that this approach cannot be successful unless we strengthen our cross-partner or cross-sector partnerships in the way that we plan, invest in strategies for young children, in the way that we share expertise and communicate across fields and disciplines, whether that's health, nutrition, child protection, education, and in parenting across the board. It also means that we need to coordinate services, and for me in particular, that means making it easier and more feasible for parents to navigate the complex multiple services that they need to access for their young children. So in order to design these packages, what are the core evidence-based principles or scientific principles we need to use to bring these multiple interventions together? There are four key evidence-based principles that I would like to draw your attention to. The first is that we all acknowledge we need to begin early. And for the most part, we have started to recognize this means the first 1,000 days of life, from pregnancy through to age 2. However, it also draws attention to preconception care, particularly in communities where women are vulnerable to poor health and poor malnutrition. It draws our attention to interventions that are ECD sensitive, that support our goals, such as family planning and birth spacing. All of these things mean that we need to consider the life cycle. The impetus to really start early begins because of our knowledge of the science of brain development. We know that the first 2 to 3 years of life is when the brain is developing at its most rapid, when the foundations for our health, our learning, our behavior pathways are being developed. And while this process is fairly robust, it is the experiences that a child is exposed to in the environment that can moderate the quality of healthy brain development. In other words, we need nutrition to nourish, to feed the brain. We need early learning and stimulation to spark the brain. And we need protective interventions to buffer the brain's healthy development so that it can endure any risk that the child might be exposed to in the environment. Starting early means intervening so that the risk factors are mitigated. When a child has risk factors that outweigh the protective factors in early life, it means they have a poor developmental trajectory, as shown by this lower red arrow. However, in the scenario that we would like to see, where the protective factors outweigh the risk factors, children's development into adulthood is of a healthy trajectory. It means that the adult has good mental health, good physical health, and is able to take advantage of education and economic opportunities. The earlier we intervene to mitigate and reduce risk factors, to support and promote early childhood development, we can reduce these inequalities between disadvantaged and advantaged populations. We have the knowledge, we have the tools, we have simple interventions that we can use to do this. One example is the recommendations developed by the World Health Organization and UNICEF in the form of Care for Child Development. These are simple messages across the first 3 years of life that focus on improving early learning from birth through play activities. It's important when we know that so many households in low and middle income countries are unable to or do not know how to provide early learning opportunities for their young children. These evidence-based messages also focus on responsive caregiving, that is, the role of the caregiver in being engaged in young children's learning development through play. Again, we know this is important because up to a third of parents report that they do not engage in caregiver-child interaction through play to support their children's learning. So what do these recommendations actually look like when we integrate them into a sector? A common sector where these messages should be integrated is the health sector. Why? It's simply because this means that we can intervene from the first moments of life. The health sector has a responsibility in engaging with pregnant women. It is likely to be the sector that first interacts with newborns and young infants. So one example is integrating the simple play, communication, and responsive caregiving messages in Road to Health cards, where alongside nutrition tracking, alongside immunization tracking, we place equal value on interventions for promoting early development through play. And in a way, we are also able to track the achievement of milestones for development. Another example from the Caribbean is integrating these messages into well baby visits. Here, in an example from Jamaica, from Antigua and St. Lucia, these simple caregiving messages around play and around responsive caregiving were integrated into 5 well baby contacts in the first 18 months of life. So while parents were with their children in the waiting room, they were shown demonstrations about how to play with their young children and why it was important. These messages were reinforced by the physicians and the nurses. And at the end result was an improvement in children's cognitive, language, and social-emotional development. But context matters. So when we take interventions like this that have been proven to be effective, we need to consider how they need to be adapted to the context that we work in. This was successful because in this region, or in this particular settings, there was high uptake and participation of well baby visits. In countries and contexts where I work, that might not be the case. So I need to think about what would this intervention look like, be shaped, adapted to work in a healthcare setting, in my setting. The second evidence-based principle is that interventions need to have multiple inputs. We need to think not about single interventions, but about packages of care. This is because there are multiple risk factors that impact early childhood development. These might be biological in nature, like malnutrition, and they may also be psychosocial in nature, for example, inadequate early stimulation, maternal depression, and exposure to violence. If we tackle any one of these individually, we are supporting children's development. But if we tackle multiple risk factors together, we are amplifying that benefit. A very brief example is an analysis of nutrition interventions. We analyzed interventions that were implemented in low and middle income countries in the first 2 years of life. We found that these interventions consistently benefited children's nutrition and growth outcome. However, when it came to development or cognitive development specifically, they only had a small impact on children's cognitive outcomes. In other words, nutrition is important, but alone it isn't sufficient to tackle the challenge of improving children's cognitive development. When we looked at stimulation interventions in the same vein, implementation of interventions for young children in the first 2 years of life in low and middle-income countries, we found that they had a consistently medium to high impact on children's cognitive development. In other words, if we combine nutrition and stimulation, we're not only going to see an impact on nutrition interventions and nutritional outcomes for young children, we're going to see an amplified effect by being able to benefit multiple outcomes of young children and strengthen early childhood development. It is important and practical that we see how these interventions align together. They have a common window of opportunity for the intervention to be implemented. They both rely on the caregiver's knowledge and skills to provide for the child. And they both rely on a frontline worker that is able to integrate and complement these messages for the caregivers so that they work well together. And it isn't only the health sector that can package this as example. In Colombia, nutrition and stimulation were combined together in a conditional cash transfer program. In Uganda, this same package was adapted for an emergency feeding center. And in Pakistan, this same package of nutrition and stimulation was packaged together in a community health worker program. Across all three examples, we saw benefits to caregivers and benefits to children that were over and above what the routine service was already providing, demonstrating that it is feasible to integrate and strengthen children's development through existing platforms. The third evidence-based message is that we can't focus on the child alone. We need to pay greater and greater attention to the well-being and the resources and the capacity of caregivers. This means promoting caregiver competencies so that they can provide the holistic inputs for their young children. It also means paying attention to the caregiver's physical health and their mental health. To illustrate this, in low and middle income countries, 15% of women experience maternal depression in antenatal period. And this is 20% during the postpartum period, twice that we see in high income countries. Without tackling maternal depression alongside interventions that focus specifically on the child, we reduce the capacity of caregivers to look after their own health and well-being, as well as the care and well-being of their young children. We also need to ensure that caregivers have the resources to act on the messages and advice we provide. This might mean coordination with cash transfer programs for the poorest households. It might mean coordination to ensure that families have access to affordable and quality childcare services so that parents can go out to work and invest resources in their young children. It might include two-generational approaches where we focus on the capacity development for caregivers. So this might be through vocational training, it might be through adult literacy programs. But all of these provide an enabling environment for young children to thrive. In addition to parents, we want to pay greater and greater attention to our workforce for early childhood. If we don't invest in their competencies, whether that's teachers, whether that's community health workers, whether that's child protection officers, we are going to fail the services in which they are expected to provide early childhood promoted interventions. The final evidence-based principle is that it's not enough to focus on just the 1,000 days or just preschool. We need to consider how we boost early gains across the life course. To illustrate this, I want to talk about an example from Pakistan. We integrated parenting and nutrition interventions in the Lady Health Worker program while children were in the first 2 years of life, and we saw great benefits to children's outcomes. However, 2 years later, when children were ready for preschool, we found that only 25% of them in this rural community had access to either formal or informal early childhood care and education services. In other words, unless we think about the continuity and the connection between sectors like health and education, we are failing to take advantage of early gains that might be made when we begin interventions early. So the Lancet series published last year provided examples of how we can use these evidence-based principles to create packages that have synergies together. These might be family support packages which strengthen caregiver skills. It might be multi-generational nurturing care packages which focus on the needs of the parents as well as the needs of the child. And it might bring together early learning and child protection packages so that children have holistic care in the home and in the classroom environment. There are examples of successful multi-sectoral programs. One example that I've highlighted here is the Chile Crece Contigo program. This provides health, early learning, and social protection services from pregnancy through to age 5. It's led by the Ministry of Social Development in partnership with the Ministries of Health and Education and brings together government and non-government providers in partnership. So what makes this program successful? Firstly, it focuses on evidence-based principles. It starts early, there are multiple inputs, there is continuity of care from the prenatal period through age 4. It doesn't replicate services that already exist. Preschool services exist in Chile. It doesn't try to duplicate those services, but looks at what is missing before children enter preschool. But in addition to these evidence-based principles, there is a strong vision and leadership. And this means that the program is championed. That means that there is good intersectoral coordination of defined roles, responsibilities, and trust between partners. So this is a complementation between evidence-based factors that make interventions work with practical, feasible, multi-sectoral connections being made across sectors to ensure that all children are reached in an important period of the life course. So how do we take this learning and work together in implementation partnerships around research, practice, and policy to address opportunities and challenges that multi-sectoral approaches offer us? This is important because there are many programs that are out there. Some work well, some work not so well. The challenge for us is we don't know how to explain or how to improve programs that are already implemented. So we need to have information that allows us to take what works successfully to scale, to make multi-sectoral programming functional so that there is quality, and we need to ensure that there is equity across these programs, that these interventions should reach all children, including children with disabilities and other marginalized groups. This means that we have to have a renewed agenda around implementation research to practice. That's been defined by the Fogarty Center in the US as the translation of evidence into practice. It can be used in the health sector, but it can be also used in the education, social protection, child protection sectors. It means researchers don't work in isolation, but the research agendas, questions, priorities, and the testing of interventions happens in partnership in real-world settings. So testing interventions in systems, not outside of systems. And last month, we published in the Annals of the New York Academy of Sciences a series of best practices based on evidence of good examples from around the world of implementation, research, and practice partnerships. I would like to draw your attention to five key lessons that we learned when we worked on this special series. And they centered around these implementation features. How do we promote effective delivery? How do we support the workforce? How do we use data in a way that is meaningful to improve multi-sectoral approaches? How do we advocate for multi-sectoral approaches? And what cost does this have for programming? The first lesson is that the traditional vertical approach to scaling up programs does not work. That is, we have small trials, and the trials get bigger, and they get even bigger. We still come across challenges when we need to adapt those evidence-based interventions into real-world services and programs. So it's important from the outset that we design with that reality in context, that we design scalable units. That means a collaborative and iterative approach. It means having good landscape mapping. We're all very familiar with the need to adapt interventions for cultural reasons, for linguistic reasons, but we need to ensure that our formative research goes beyond this so that we're mapping the services that exist, we're mapping the competencies of workforces, we're mapping where there are opportunities for cross-sector coordination, we're mapping where the gaps are so that we can identify where we can start to implement interventions and how we can integrate them in a way that suits the actual services that they will be operating in. We can use this data to create theory of change, which helps us to understand what works and for which outcomes. It also means that once we have an adapted package, the job is not done. The adaptation work continues in testing cycles inside of the system. This means that the theory of change is based on action research. We recognize that programs that include a theory of change that meets the needs of the target population, addresses gaps, and measures those changes are more successful and impact children's development than programs that don't include a theory of change. And that means the theory of change has to be understood by the beneficiaries. Yet, when we analyzed almost 350 studies, parenting interventions, nutrition interventions, and integrated packages, we found that actually only 20% of nutrition interventions included a theory of change. Only 60% of parenting interventions included a theory of change, and only 40% of integrated interventions included a theory of change. In other words, this is a key feature that we can improve our implementation work around. Again, once we have that package developed for our context, we need to be able to test it in cycles such as the plan, do, study, act cycle, which basically means that we hand the work over to the service providers to test in short intervention cycles. It means that they are the ones who are informing us how the adaptation can be refined in order to make these interventions work, whether it's in a health service, whether it's in an education service, or another service. And this has been successful across the health sector. It was successful in Ghana, where a basic evidence-based package was shared across primary healthcare facilities to improve newborn care. But each primary healthcare facility had the responsibility to be able to modify and tailor that package to their needs to make it work. By doing this, it took a long time, but it was able to impact the outcomes for young children. We can certainly translate these types of practices to nurturing care and early childhood development. The second lesson is integrating techniques of behavior change. We recognize that sharing information about child development isn't enough to help parents and caregivers uptake new practices to support their children's development. Yet, so many of our interventions still rely on information sharing alone. Instead, we know that if we use activities such as coaching, demonstrations, problem solving, peer support, we're likely to have a better impact on children's development. And the more behavior change techniques we use, the better it is for children's outcome. So again, this is another key piece of practical implementation design we can integrate into our programs. The third lesson from implementation research and practice is to invest in a skilled workforce. This means that we need to invest in high quality training, but the effort doesn't stop at the period of training. In research, I have the luxury of being able to train frontline workers for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, but in real systems, that might be reduced to 3 days, 2 days, 5 days. How do we make that work? Well, we require a supportive supervision system. We know that programs that include attention to supportive supervision achieve better outcomes for young children, and the evidence generally suggests 2 contacts a month. Yet, when we analyze the studies that are available around early childhood, we see that, again, only 20% of nutrition interventions provide and report information on supportive supervision strategies, and only about half of parenting interventions and integrated interventions currently provide information on supportive supervision. Again, this is an issue that we can tackle when we translate evidence into practice. It means not just monitoring what our frontline providers do, but providing feedback to them in a timely manner so they can improve their delivery of interventions. It means not only improving the skills of the health worker, but upgrading the skills of the supervisors. The supervisors that work in the education sector, the supervisors that work in the child protection sector, and the social protection sector as well. And the net result of doing this in Pakistan, at least, is that we see there's a growth in confidence in the people that provide these services and increased motivation among the frontline workers. The fourth lesson that we've learned around implementation research to practice is we need to focus on demand. Much of our work has really focused on the supply side of intervention. But demand is equally important. This means going beyond simply raising knowledge and awareness about children's development, but really having empowered beneficiaries that can act as agents of change. An example of this is from a program to improve private early education, or the PIPE program, implemented by FSG in partnership with low-cost private preschools in urban settings in India. Here, there was no question that parents were not demanding preschool education. The question was, how did the intervention improve knowledge among parents so they could make choices and act on choosing between a high-quality preschool that offers child-centered approaches versus a more traditional or low-quality preschool that doesn't necessarily benefit children's readiness for school? They did this through working with sensitization experiences of parents by providing them with data and information about what their children were achieving so that they could actively support and make choices about the types of preschools they were sending their children to. They balanced this by also including a supply side so that as demand for high quality preschool interventions increased among caregivers, that they were able to supply and respond to that demand by having preschools ready to basically focus on more child-centered approaches. This approach is being scaled up to reach larger and larger numbers of young children. The final message is around measuring both impact as well as implementation quality. We've had a lot of attention on how do we measure children's development, but in programs, we need to be able to track the entire program cycle and know that we're on track to make a difference on children's development. This means understanding whether the program is implemented as planned or the fidelity of the program. It means understanding what it costs to implement this program. And it means learning about why something is working and why something is not working so that we can make active choices about how to improve programs. This means not only measuring children's development, but measuring factors along that pathway. So does caregiving change? If we're depending on caregivers to provide holistic care, do we see uptake of new practices? These are proxy measures that tell us whether our programs are likely to be successful or not successful. It also means answering the questions that policymakers are interested in. To give one example, in Pakistan, we were constantly challenged that if we're going to integrate a stimulation intervention into a community health worker service, does that mean the community health workers would stop implementing routine health interventions? We monitored this to find out if that was the case. And what we found, for example, if you look at hand washing, in the routine health services or the control group, only 5% of households received information from the community health worker about hand washing. But as a result of training and supportive supervision, in the integrated packages which combined ECD and nutrition along with the routine health services, these intervention deliveries were optimized so that more households were receiving not only ECD messaging, but also routine health advice. In order to be able to inform the choices that we have about how to improve programs, we need to capture data over time. But most importantly, we need to use data. It can't simply be used for reports that are put on our shelves. We need to be able to provide information that means that we can provide feedback to our frontline workers, feedback to our policymakers about investment choices, and feedback to program implementers about what interventions they need to strengthen and to focus on. That means we need to timely disseminate information and present it in a language that means action can be taken. In order to really achieve this, it requires strong partnerships. This can't be done by practitioners in isolation or by academics in isolation or by policymakers in isolation. It requires research to practice partnerships. This means learning collaboratives. One example is the Home Visiting Network in the US, which allows home visitors to work with researchers to identify the challenges they face in delivering their home visiting programs and to prioritize those for action, for improvements and evaluation. These kind of networks mean there has to be a research practice culture in the programs that we implement, and this is something that we can work towards in the long term. It means fostering and funding research to practice communities, including the funding of process and implementation evaluations. So we're not only focusing on just the end impact result, which might come in 5 years' time, but really looking at the steps along the way. It means establishing small innovation funds that can be accessed by practitioners to try and test new interventions that can improve the functioning of their programs. And it means improving access to learning, whether that's research reports or whether that's program evaluations that often get siloed or hidden in ways that we can't all access them as a child development community. So in summary, we know why we need to invest in the early years, but in moving forward, we really need to map out clear, evidence-based examples of good practices that allows us to follow a sequence of steps that translates those evidence-based practice into effective adaptation that allows us to integrate, test, and evaluate interventions in systems with the idea that there will always be a continuous cycle of improvement. That means we need to strengthen what happens within individual sectors by using science better, by being more practical in our decision making, and by strengthening existing platforms. There is no point integrating new interventions without considering how we improve the functioning and quality of existing services. And it means that we need to think much more deliberately about multi-sectoral coordination. We need leadership and decision makers that have the authority to make those decisions. We need to develop the competencies for understanding what makes cross-sector coordination work. And we need consistency of messaging across sectors. It is not helpful if parents hear one thing from their physician, another thing from the educator, and another thing perhaps in a social welfare program. And it's only when we have this continuity of services from home to school can we really truly support young children's development. This means that business as usual is not going to make a dent in reducing the number of children that are currently failing to meet their developmental potential. But we do have good examples, we do have an understanding about why they work, and we do understand the features of implementation that we need to tackle when designing our scalable programs. Thank you.